advertisers have requested me to start. So this morning, I'm going to talk to you about a number of issues which are associated with sports and have also concerns you either from the medical aspects or the anti-doping aspects. So these are pressing issues. I'm sure many of you have come across some of them either directly or indirectly. And so I hope that I will be able to update your knowledge as to the present status of practice or present status of belief within the sporting fraternity. Now, the involvement we have as doctors or medical personnel in sports, we can look at three components. The first component is our doctor business. Okay, we are concerned about the prevention, the treatment, and rehabilitation of illnesses and injuries. That's our core business. That's what we train in medical school and nursing school and physiotherapy school, to really to treat athletes, to prevent them from having their illness or injury, and if they have it, to get them back on their feet as quickly as we can. That's our core business. The second business we have is where some of us have branched into the appropriate sciences. Apart from being medical personnel, we contribute towards the legitimate use of sports science to improve training methods and performance. Now, training methods and performance have evolved over the decades. I mean, in the old days, people, you know, maybe train just 3 weeks before the competition, the first Olympic Games or something like that. Today it's become a full-time affair. You know, with large entourage, he showed you a picture of all the people involved. Today, the rough average for a top athlete, the entourage is 8 to 10 people. You know, starting with the manager, the coach, the nutritionist, the dietitian, the psychologist, the physiotherapist, 8 people, you know. And that's called an entourage. And today, the international sports community and even the World Anti-Doping Agency has accepted this category of people called the entourage. And they're also making rules to control the entourage. Okay, and this is going to be the next big feature of the WADA code revision, is how to handle the entourage, because they have found out that today, hardly any athlete is minding his own business. It's all his entourage is minding his business. And quite often, we are punishing only the athlete, or we are only rewarding the athlete and not rewarding the entourage or punishing them when they do that. You know? So the entourage is going to become a more prominent feature as time goes on. And we are all part of this entourage in one way or another. All right. So those of us who have learned this thing, we use it legitimately. We teach our athletes the right things to train, the right way to avoid injury, the right way to improve your vital capacity, the right way to improve your cardiac output or your muscular strength or anything. There are honest ways. That's what training is all about. Training either, you know, using the sport itself or weight training, resistance training. I mean, we have all our modalities. These are not secrets now, you know. You can read them in any book. But it's a question of application. Of course, some top coaches will claim they got secret methods, but that is another story. But constant research is going on, you know. And if you keep in touch with the journals and everything, you will find all the new techniques of how to improve stamina, how to improve speed, how to improve recovery, all this legitimately, all right? And the third one we have, the third business we have is, we have the knowledge to keep sports fair and clean. We can also play dirty, but we have the knowledge. It's a double-edged sword. Some of our colleagues, sadly to say, are part of the entourage that's causing the problem. Sad to say. I mean, I don't want to point fingers countries or people, but you know this is happening. And I can tell you without any malice that when the Berlin Wall came down in 1989 and people went in, what did they find? They found all the secret files of how one government was condoning and actually had a doping department. So all of you, whenever you all go and form committees and form associations, please call it the anti-doping committee or anti-doping department. Don't say this is a doping committee of the Pakistan Olympic Association. because there were such committees before who actually his business is to dope the athletes, you know. In a government, organized government funded fashion, they found all these files. And they you know, put the fellows in jail even. And can you imagine, I'll give you one example. There was a swimmer in 1976 Olympic called Barbershop, Shirley Barbershop. Shirley Barbershop made history by winning 6 silver medals. I mean, Mark Spitz won 7 gold medals, but Shirley Babashaw in 1976 Montreal won 6 silver medals. Is it good or bad? Sad, isn't it? And who were the 6 people who beat her? All East German swimmers. And all in 1989, they found the files. All of them had been doped. So what do you do from 1989 to 1976? Return the medals too late. Okay. I was 11 years old when I went to secondary school, and to say we are fit enough to enter the pool. But they don't do this anymore. They don't do this anymore. Those days, without that certificate, there was no way in which the teacher would have let me jump in.
Without those polio drops.
They will not jump in the pool, you know. So today, somehow we have dropped all this. Some good habits we have dropped, you know. And it's funny because now we have the resources. Those days, the hospital only have 2 doctors. And yet that fellow is spending half the time giving certificates for children to jump in the pool. Right. So anyhow, this is something that is going to come back, and I think we should start to work towards this pre-participation examination. Now, I'm also going to talk to you about some topics in keeping sports fair and clean, which is on anti-doping, gender verification. You might have heard of this issue, where we have the issue of complaints by some people that, hey, that guy is in the girl's head. He's not a girl. So what do you do? At least come to complain. So we as a medical commission, what do we do? We have to do something about it. We cannot ignore it. At the same time, we have to be very delicate. I will tell you what we are supposed to do. The next is the new issue which is going to come up in the next few generations, next decades, is this issue of gene doping. Alright? What did they do? Last time we take drugs. Now we continue to take drugs for doping. But what they're going to do is, they have found the mechanism to manipulate genes, so that, you know, you can get the right genes to perform better. Okay. Age cheating. Now this is another phenomenon now. You got these youth games, youth Olympics now. In the youth division, sometimes we see people who actually, I mean, they look so much older, you know. Very clearly they have mustaches and some of them look 25 years old. But if you check for their documents, they're still underage because some of them didn't go to take documents for 10 years. I mean, that happens in villages and all that. You know, or some actually forge these documents. There's so many things. So we as doctors have to come up with methods to screen them and tell you some bit of that. Then there are other issues which keep coming up in the media as well as in conferences, seminars. A few things. One is the use of something called the altitude chamber. We all know. Altitude training was fashionable at one time. So now you don't even have to go there. They've got chambers in which you can sit inside and pretend you're at the altitude. They can manipulate it. So we'll talk about the pros and cons of that. Then they have another thing that keeps coming up. It's been referred to already with the no needle policy. Is the injection of PRP, is platelet-rich plasma, you know, which a lot of people believe has got factors which can hasten recovery of muscular injuries. I'll talk a little bit about that. And finally, the issue of intravenous infusion. Again, there are rules for this. Of course, a dehydrated athlete after a marathon will need it, and you don't hold it back from him. But there are other people who are giving this as performance enhancers before our competition, you know, for various reasons. We'll talk about that too. Okay, so let's come first to doping control. Now, the terms are used almost exchangeably, anti-doping or doping control. Anti-doping, we now prefer the term anti-doping because a lot of measures that we do against doping is not just testing, you know, we've got other measures. So we prefer to use the word anti-doping. The word doping control somehow implies mostly taking athletes and testing them. So if you're forming organizations or associations or anything like that, try to use the word anti-doping because that worldwide they recognize as the appropriate term for you, for us to use when we're associated with it. So why do we have anti-doping or sporting control or doping control? Because we want to continue to make sports the last bastion of human endeavor where things seem to be done right and fair and clean. I think no country, I mean, you see on television every day. I mean, people are so fed up of governments and politicians and whatnot. You know, I mean, rightly or wrongly, I don't know. I'm not here to make judgment on that. But, you know, they can find so many things wrong. You know, and every time we look to sports as a sort of final bastion, where we can say, okay, let them do the hell, let's go and enjoy our sport. One place where you can sit down, you know, during a football game, enjoy the game, shout as much as you want, call everybody an idiot. You are the best player after all sitting in the stands. You can do much better than the players inside. You have the freedom to shout anything you want and you go home happy. Forget all your problems and all your house is going to be foreclosed, never mind, but you went to see the football match. Okay, so this was the thing about sports. So we want to try to preserve that. So when all these ugly things come, I think we have got a responsibility to try to do things to preserve sport. Secondly, the various drugs and methods that they use have got serious side effects. There's no doubt about it. All of them have got some side effect or other which is going to reduce the lifespan of the athlete. It is not a secret that athletes who took a lot of drugs during their lifespan don't last very long. There are a number of examples, you know, the wrestlers, weightlifters and so on, hardly see 50th birthday, you know. And then you get some female athletes getting heart attacks. Females not supposed to get heart attacks. Now all of you are protected by your estrogens, you know, as opposed to us. You see what hard lives we have. So, you know, you're supposed to be protected and you don't expect a lady of 36 to have a heart attack. You know, normally. Am I right?
Not harder than delivery.
Huh?
Not harder than delivery.
Exactly. So anyway, but this happening among some, I don't want to mention names again. Why? Because they've been taking drugs and offsetting the protective effect of estrogen. They've been taking testosterone-like analogs, so they begin to suffer the side effects of males. That's the price they pay. Okay. Then thirdly, all of us use athletes as role models. Now, you know, I mean, even in the last few days, every now and then I hear of the icons in cricket in Pakistan. Their names, everybody's lips. And not only that, yesterday I had a chance to drive around a little bit around your sports complex and I see all the names, you know, either on the door or somewhere. You know, I mean, they're icons. I've taken photos taking home to Malaysia hoping they'll put my name somewhere in some box. Anyway, they haven't done that, but never mind. Maybe Pakistan can teach them. But anyhow, so we like role models. And you like them to be clean cut. You know, when a guy wins a gold medal, you like to know that he won through hard work and honest competition. He didn't pay some bribe to some bookie to ensure that he won, you know. So we would like to believe that. So similarly, we don't like athletes to be well known for having taken a drug. For instance, there are one group of lobby which says, hey look, why are you making so much fun? After all, if taking drugs is going to perform better performances, break records, why are we outlawing it? It's a free world. Let every athlete take it. No, why bother? Can you imagine the next time if we really open the door and say, okay, now that drugs is just like good food. So if people are allowed to eat good food, why not take drugs? Then otherwise, why not ban meat and say that no athlete must take meat? You know, I mean, I'm talking, you know, because meat gives us the amino acids or whatever it is. So you can go to that extent. Or somebody says ban all free all drugs. So you know what will happen up there? Olympic Games will not be about countries. The march past won't be Australia, Argentina and all that. March past will be Pfizer, Glaxo, all the drug companies, Rembaxi and whatnot. Because they'll be the ones now after that controlling sport. So the march past of drug companies, all right? So teams who are supported by these, you know. So this is a ridiculous extent it can go to if we don't ban this and don't stop this. And drugs can unfairly enhance performance. Drugs can damage health and even cause death. There's a lot of history. You go into the internet, you will find, at least in the last few years, at least 10 drug-related deaths in sports. Young fellows, 20 plus, after cycle race, after a weightlifting competition, in football, anywhere, you know, sudden deaths. And quite a lot of them have been attributed to drug use. And the whole drug thing exploded in international sport and got the attention. Why? In 1960, one Danish cyclist called Jensen, a young fellow 20 plus, after he finished his cycling race, he just put a bicycle and dropped dead. And of course, when a young man drops dead, they must do an autopsy. And what they found, his whole body was soaking with amphetamine. Alright? So that started the whole process of them realizing there's drug use in sport, forming medical commission, having anti-doping rules. It took all, that was the first step. So basically, that's why we do this. Okay? And what do these guys take mostly? Of course, the most common use is to increase strength. They take male hormones and steroids. to increase stamina, they take EPO or these analogs, or they do blood doping. Blood doping, there are many ways. You actually can transfuse your own blood, you take out your blood, keep in the fridge, put it back, you know, after your marrow has regenerated some. So many ways in which you do blood doping. And to stimulate, some of the people need stimulation just before the short explosive events, they take amphetamines, etc. And then to move classes, this is another very common practice. You know, I mean, in the sports we have classes, and with your weight. So what they do is they take diuretics to just before the weighing in, so that they will drop a class, and then after that put back all the fluid and punch all the little boys. You know, so they play around with these classes. And finally, they can use drugs to mask other drugs. So they use diuretics, they use epitestosterone to mark testosterone use because it will affect the TE ratio. And then they use blood diluters, you know, because after having taken EPO and not just before, test take plasma expenders. So that when you go for the test, your hematocrit and so on will be normal, you know. So these are tricks that athletes use. Okay. Now, every now and then, we are caught with a situation where an athlete is found positive. All right, so immediately all hell breaks loose, isn't it? Can you imagine whether some games or Olympic games or anywhere, the moment an athlete, it's called positive, all hell breaks loose. Now, I remember very clearly, 1988, you know, I was there as a volunteer with the anti-doping group. And, you know, those days, like PCOs, you know, but we volunteer, we had to get there on our own, but they'll give us the uniform, the cap and the t-shirt, okay? So I was one of those fellows, and, you know, we get a chance to see some of the competition, so I managed to see the 100-meter final, which Ben Johnson won, you know. Ben Johnson won the 100 meters. Of course, the world went wild, and Canada went even wilder. The Canada was so proud about this Canadian, you know, and they were cheering from Vancouver to Montreal. Okay, they're cheering this great Canadian who became the world's fastest man. 24 hours, when the result came out, all hell break loose, and he was then a Jamaican immigrant. Right? So, and that started the second wave of the anti-doping movement. That led to the formation of the World Anti-Doping Agency. Because the Canadians took it seriously, they formed a commission, you know, judicial commission called a doping commission. And then from there, it led to everything, finally led to the formation of WADA. So everyone has, everything you look back in history has got a trigger, you know. So the first one was Jensen, the Danish fellow, who collapsed after a cycle race. Second one is Ben Johnson, who created history, and then, you know, everything went into place. So, okay, all hell breaks loose. So what we need to think, how this happens. I recognize three circumstances in which an athlete tests positive. The first circumstance, which is actually very common, is what I call the accidental case. A lot of athletes, they actually get caught positive by accident. Accident meaning what? They didn't mean to go and cheat anybody or anything. They actually went and got a medication or took a food supplement or sometimes they went to the village and grandma said, look, you know, in our generation, we've been drinking this tonic for the last 37 years. All right, now, why are you not drinking? So he gives the fellow, he drinks and comes back and fails the test, strychnine inside. All right? So, or he goes to buy, he goes to another place and he's having a cold, sneezing away, he goes to the pharmacy in the airport and buys an anti-cold pill. Next thing they have inside there, some ephedrine or something, you know. So these are the things, real accidental. The second one is what I call the victim. The victim are all these athletes who hardly know anything about all this. Many of them don't even understand the anti-doping rules or the prohibited list or anything. Many of our athletes, I mean, they're not at that educational level to worry about all this. So when a coach or some entourage member tells them, look, this is the best thing for you to take, I'll give you injection 3 times a week, it's very good for your health and all that, the guy will say, okay, sir. I mean, they don't argue with their coaches, you know. And some of it is just one coach doing this. Sometimes it's a whole organization. Sometimes it's a whole government. All right, we have had examples of all of this. So what do you call the athlete? I call him a victim. You know, he really didn't get involved, but he's in a position where if he says no, they'll say, get lost. Leave the camp. Go away, you know. You're not a team player. So I call him the victim. And the third one is the willful fellow. The one who actually knowingly, you know, and or, you know, very systematically he's taking drugs because he understands, he knows what he's doing, he's clever enough, and he's rich enough, and he understands all this, and this is part of his strategy. So we somehow have to deal with this. But at the bottom, underlying think, don't ever forget that whatever, whether you are accidental victim or willful, the punishment is according to the strict liability rule. The strict liability rule is one of the underlying principles of the whole WADA code and the anti-doping movement, meaning that it is the responsibility of each and individual athlete to be personally responsible for anything that he puts in his body, even if somebody else gives him. He has to be personally responsible. Three circumstances I give you. Where he's going and taking it voluntarily, he should always think, what am I putting inside me? Alright? Secondly, anybody is coming, even his best friend, best coach, coming, giving him something, he should learn how to ask, hey, what is this? Have you gone and tested this? Are you sure this will not cause me a problem? Same thing, he goes to see a GP, the GP doesn't know the prohibited list. He gives him a drug, he says, sir, I'm an athlete, you know, I have this prohibited list, maybe carry the thing with him. You know, they are in small booklets now. He can actually go to a GP and show, isn't it? What's so hard about that, huh? So anyway, so he has some responsibility. Alright? And even if there's a situation where he says, you know, I was having my shower, I put my bag there, and then I had this bottle of drink in my bag, and somebody has poured this thing into my bottle. Now again, he's liable. Who asked him to put his bag there? You know, I mean, he can say he left his bag, so, but he must learn now as a habit, huh? We make him responsible. Okay, my bag cannot be just kept anywhere where people can enter. These are responsibilities. You know, I mean, after all, you know, how many of us will pay a taxi man and then can't find the wallet? Isn't it? So he must be responsible. Responsible, so he must know where to keep it. Okay, so athletes must be trained there, huh? Must be trained there. Okay, so he has to be taught this strict liability rule somehow. Okay, having said that, people understand, in the last time, before the last code revision, they used to punish across the board using this strict liability rule. But today, in the latest code revision, they have adopted this thing for flexibility called specified substances. So what are specified substances? Specified substances are listed in the prohibited list, clearly listed, which are substances which have a way of getting into other things, you know, very easily, because in cough mixtures or in nutrients or anything like that, very commonly. So if any of these substances are found and the athlete has a reasonable story to tell how it could have got inside his body, then we have an option of reducing the sentence from, say, 2 years to 6 months or 1 year, or even if it's really good case, then even not punishing him but giving him a severe warning. So there's a range. So this range is based on the so-called adoption of specified substances. So how have the testing people responded? I mean, the anti-doping agencies. It's not just testing alone. So they responded by education and awareness. We have established rules and regulations. We do testing during and out of competition, and we do sanctions to serve as a deterrent. So it's a combined approach. So these are our pillars of strategies. And we have some instruments to give us this strength. One is the WADA code. Alright? Those of you who have read the WADA code, fine. Those you haven't read, it's no problem. You just go to the WADA website, www.wada-ama.org. The -AMA, the AMA is the French equivalent of WADA, Anti-Mondial Agency. AMA. So you go in there, you can download all the WADA documents. Alright, so you don't need to really carry the books around. So the WADA code is the enabling instrument, and associated with the WADA code, to give it all the details, is what is known as the International Standards for Testing, for Laboratories, and for the TUEs. TUEs are Therapeutic Use Exception. So they have international standards, and that's what governs us. Then they have a prohibited list. This prohibited list is also valid year by year. It's valid from 1st January to 31st December. And around September, they invite opinions and they have a committee which meets to see whether any changes should be made to the code. So the changes will be advertised around November and they will be implemented for the next year. So currently now, we have the code for 2012. So any games or any out of competition that's done during this period we govern by the 2012 code. But around September, they will write to the whole world, you know, they send everywhere, and you got an opinion, you can even send it. And they have a committee, they will study all these opinions and decide. And they do this every year. Like one time, you know, caffeine was a prohibited drug. Now it's taken off. Because they realize caffeine is in so many beverages, not forgetting caffeine is a staple product of Coca-Cola, major sponsor of the Olympic Games. So now, prohibited list there. Siroj has given me a sample, huh? So give this to your athletes. So they carry, you know, in your wallet. So anytime they go and see a GP, you can say, sir, you know, this is what I cannot take, can you have a look before you give me? Why not? Yeah.
So put all the caffeine from the prohibited list. There is some professional issues are just like Coca-Cola sponsor or also it's not the harmful part that we
now that we should organize a seminar for them. Okay, it's a big debate, you know? Okay. The fact remains they took it off, okay? Because they found that both scientifically as otherwise, there may be no grounds not to leave it there. Okay. There's another debate. We can talk about our whole day until our next coffee break. So that's a prohibited list. Huh? I think it's a very good idea. Make one and give your athletes. So I think this is something they carry in the wallet. And anytime they have to see somebody who's giving them medicine, they show them. And like I said, the doctor, and not only that, because the proprietary names the doctor may not know, you know. I mean, these carry generic names. There's so many brands, and the brands vary from country to country. I mean, your own local manufacturer calls it something else. Nobody else in the world will recognize, you know. So, but these drug website I told you about, they actually try to learn every name in the world, you know. So if you put the country you're asking, they will know how to reply to you whether the drug you're prescribing is banned or not. So even a GP, if he's in doubt, he can go in the internet and check the drug. Okay? So that's a prohibited list. Then they have these accredited laboratories. Now the testing can only be done in accredited laboratories. Today there are 33 of them around the world. Okay. Now there's a very strict process. It's an expensive process, and to keep the accreditation is as difficult as getting it. Now in Asia, there used to be 6, now there are 5, and sadly, you know, I must say the one lab that's been suspended is a lab from Malaysia. Okay, we have one lab and that's been suspended. Now, not only suspended, it's been revoked, so now they are reapplying. So let's hope they get it. But otherwise, the labs in Asia, yes?
So why it was suspended?
Okay, let me tell you. One is, let me tell you the labs in Asia now. The labs in Asia are the one in Tokyo, the one in Seoul, the one in Beijing, the one in Bangkok, and the one in New Delhi. Now actually one sixth one has recently got it for the Asian Winter Games is Kazakhstan. And so there were 7, one was Penang in Malaysia. Last year they had a problem with a nandrolone test involving an Egyptian footballer playing a game in Saudi Arabia or something like that, where they made a technical error on the diagnosis based on the international standards, you know. So on that basis, it was thought serious enough for WADA to suspend them. They appealed against the suspension at the Court of Arbitration and lost the case. So they lost their case, and so they are now revoked. But they are in the process of reapplying. They put all those things correct. They corrected the reasons, and they are applying. So that's now these accredited laboratories. They are expensive to start because you must get the right equipment. Your staff must be well trained. And you must go through a serious accreditation process which can take 3 or 4 years. Because they will send you test specimens, they'll make site visits, all the consultants will come, they'll come on first class, stay in 7-star hotels, you know, and then they will accredit you. So it's quite an expensive process. And by the time you get your accreditation, after that, you cannot make mistakes. And secondly, you've got to keep up to date. For instance, if they change a method, and they send you a circular about a change method or a change equipment or anything, you must quickly comply. And then also, you must have minimum now 3,000 specimens a year. If you get less than 3,000, you also lose your accreditation. Not easy to get 3,000. These tests are expensive. They range from in China, in Japan is charging $300. You know, I mean, so it's your choice, huh? But it's expensive. So can you imagine how many 3,000 tests will need, how much of money? In Malaysia, what we have done is we get a government grant. The government last time used to give grant for 1,500, but that was the rule then. But last year they changed it to 3,000. So now they are applying for a grant for 3,000 tests so that at least we can keep the lab supported, you know. So the government has to give some kind of grant for this testing program. Now, all of this is at the central level, and they implemented locally, globally, through the anti-doping rules of IOC, International Federations, NOCs, NSAs, event organizers. One example is the book you have in your bag. Huh? You've got the anti-doping rules of the Pakistan. Well, that's a good example. So every organization should try to produce a booklet like that, which is your underlying instrument to carry out your programs. Okay, so the doping program is going on. Is it going perfectly?
Yeah.
Yes and no.
Yeah.
Yes. I mean, we are all doing what we can, but there are many loopholes, many challenges. So I'm going to tell you something about that. First is, this effect, we are not catching them all. In fact, we are missing large numbers. Okay, every time you catch an athlete, you're probably missing 10 times as many, because they are clever. You're catching only the fellow who is not so clever. The clever fellows with a clever entourage, they know how to skillfully manipulate their drug taking so that they don't fail the test. And that's why the out of competition testing anytime, anywhere has to be strengthened, because you need to surprise them. If they knew when you're going to test, they know how to manipulate. They know how to control it such that they can take the drug, enjoy the benefit, and still have it out of the system so that they don't fail the test. Or they take drugs, new drugs, that are called designer drugs, that they have actually taken the drug, they have changed one or two molecules so that it doesn't affect the function of the drug. You know, drugs are made of molecules. Some molecules are important for the function, other molecules are important for the structure, some other molecules are important for the design of the drug. So what they do is they very cleverly they change those other things which don't affect the function so that they'll still build the strength of the muscles and all that, but won't be detected in the test because the structure has been changed. Because the test is very specific, you know. It's picking up a certain drug, but by changing one molecule, they have changed the structure of the drug so that it won't show in your test. Alright? So there is new drugs they are making all the time. The famous one you all heard of was THG, yeah? THG. The one that broke out after the Sydney Olympics, and which led to a company called Balco, you know. They were using this drug, testosterone product, which couldn't be detected. But they were being supplied to all the athletes, you know, and based from the court cases and so on, even Marion Jones, you know, had to return all the medals, huh? Because although she never failed the test, there was enough evidence, she was sending monthly checks to this company. Why, you think it was a corporate social responsibility donation? You know? Anyway, the court held her, you know, as a purchaser and they fined her. So that was one of the instances where an athlete was sanctioned without the test being positive, based on other evidence which came out in court. Okay? Then the tests are not fully effective or not yet available. Now, this is a serious problem. See, the drug companies can, or not just the drug companies, any chemists and so on, they can manipulate with the drug and try it, you know. And once they have made a drug, all they have to do is pass a rumor that it's great. And many athletes are willing to try it. As long as somebody will persuade them, hey, this is fantastic, they say, will you try? They will try. You know. But when the testers, when they redesign in the lab, we design a test to find it, we cannot just say, hey, we got a test, we look for it. No, we have to publish in a scientific journal. Our colleagues must agree and say that this is valid. Then only after that can this test stand up in a court of law, because you are able to take up the journal and say this test has been validated. And usually that takes 3 to 5 years. You all know, those of you who publish articles, you know. All right, you go to reviewers, you go to all sorts of things, they send you back for revisions 10 times, you know. So finally, by the time you get the article published and you can carry it in a court of law and waive it, it'll be 3 years down the road and athletes have been using it. Because athletes are not waiting for this document for them to start taking the drug. They take the risk from the moment the rumor says so. Alright? So it is always the testers are 3 years, 5 years behind the doers. for a new drug. So somehow we have to shorten this period. So how do we shorten this period? We can't shorten the period through the legal, through the scientific way. We have to shorten the period through the intelligence way. Intelligence way means we must have spies everywhere. You know who will whistleblow and send anonymous notes or informers there. So WADA encourages this, to have whistleblowing and informers and all that to let us know when these things are surfacing. I mean, these things can't be kept secret very long. I mean, at least we'll talk among themselves. So if you have got people who can have a ear to the ground, you can pick up some of these things. You can test. So how do you test? Suppose you don't have a test. You don't have a test to directly find the drug. Now the system allows indirect evidence. What do I mean by indirect evidence? Alright, you are taking a steroid-like drug. Maybe we don't know the structure, so we don't have a test specifically for it, so we can't prove it. But what is the indirect evidence? You monitor the guy's steroid profile. Every one of us has got a hormonal profile like a fingerprint. Every one of us has something very unique about us. See, all of us, those of us who went to the dinner last night, we may have all eaten the same stuff. But how we metabolize it, and what urine and feces we create out of the food last night is an individual fingerprint. You know, we all ate the same thing. But suppose we tested the urine after the meal. None of us will have the same chromatograph, although we ate the same thing. Alright? Why? Because each of our body metabolizes separately. And each of us has a pattern, So if we monitor athlete's pattern over a period of time, you know what
organized doping. Now, what is organized doping? This is the one where the entourage governments are actually systematically doing, we are currently dealing with a situation in Malaysia. You might have read in the papers about last May, our anti-doping agency was doing random tests. 6 athletes ran away from the test. Track and field athletes ran away from the test. And so word was sent to them that what they're doing is illegal and they can be charged as an anti-doping rule violation, So out of the 6, 3 returned the next day, said sorry and submitted to the test. But even they actually broke a rule, even though they came back. And 3 others took a flight to Bulgaria and left. Okay? So that was the first story. And while that investigation was going on, another athlete of ours was found positive during the Southeast Asia Games. And he came and said, in his story, he has implicated a few people linking the two situations together. So basically what they are doing is they are implicating and linking a key member of the association as having got the drugs from Bulgaria and supplying to the athletes. So that is the allegation being made by the athletes. So it's all under investigation process. So what I'm trying to say is getting more and more complicated. So somehow we have to find ways of doing this. Then cover-ups, even the big organizations have been accused of cover-up. I mean, even the IOC itself has been accused from time to time, after tough matters. Then finally, the one big challenge today is what I call the legal eagles. The lawyers have jumped into this act, and they're brilliant fellows. They can find the smallest departure from your process, and they will harp on it until, the hearing panel is so impressed and will exonerate the athlete, lawyers, and it's becoming very expensive. Many of the drug-related cases have cost millions now. Many sports bodies have gone bankrupt. They actually declared bankruptcy, after paying the legal fees, including no less than the British Athletic Board a few years ago, So it's a serious business, expensive business, and we have to be careful what we do. Okay. So what are the new approaches to overcome some of these challenges? One is biological passport, I already mentioned. So what we do is, every athlete on the registered testing pool. Now there are 2 different kinds of athletes, participants and registered testing pool. Now participants are anybody who participates in sport, and they are all subject to this rule as well. Even a 10-year-old boy who goes for a primary school sports carnival, he's governed by these rules. None of us goes and harass the 10-year-old boy in the primary school, but if we want, we can. And in America, this doping is becoming younger and younger. High school children are taking this thing. Why? They want to impress the talent scout who comes to pick them for the football scholarship. So they're starting to take the drug to impress the talent scout. So it's getting younger and younger, so don't laugh about going to primary school, because some of the habits start there. So we have a right. As long as you're participating in a sport, you have, but you can't be testing the whole world, isn't it? So to focus on the top sportsmen, every sports body has to create what we call a registered testing pool of the elite. And for the registered testing pool, we have special control. One of them is this biological passport. So in track and field, the top 50 in the world in every event will be on a registered testing pool of IAF, and they have to create this biological passport. So in other words, over time, they have to show their hematological profile, the urine steroid profile will be on record. So any time that changes, that means something is going funny. Of course, he could be having a cancer. You know, he could have a tumor of an endocrine gland which can completely change all this. That's for us to investigate. All right, can happen. All right, suddenly the guy has a...
adjusted, and the reticulocyte count will be normal.
So you would take the statistical value of the...
Yes, you look at a... You know, profile is something not yes or no, like a chemical result, you know. You actually have to study the whole thing and follow for a time. You cannot do a chemical profiling on one examination. You have to find across longitudinally over a period, then you know what is his average, you see. You don't do with one estimation, you know. Alright, so now detection methods are to find better tests. WADA has got a research program. They got $5 million to give every year to research projects. So yeah, I mean, if you have scientists in your countries who are capable of doing some of these tests, you can apply every year. The application for these research funds are on the WADA website. You can send in your application by May. By August, they decide whether they'll fund you or not. So if you got scientists here who are interested in your universities and so on, they are, it's open to the whole world, you know. And they encourage everybody to apply. So if you've got colleagues, you please go ahead. Yeah.
I've got another very interesting question here. Because I've been practicing in the United States, so mostly the racial profile, as far as the hormones are concerned, were also different.
Yes.
Because the most superior physiological profile is from the black,
yes,
the African Americans.
Yeah.
They have enzymes and hormones which other races do not have.
Okay.
So they have a natural,
yes,
superiority over everybody else.
Yes.
So how does WADA then come?
So far, the anti-doping movement has not interfered with God's work.
Okay. Yeah, that explains.
Okay. Please don't take offense with that. Huh? Yeah. In a positive way.
Yeah.
What I'm trying to say is, what's nature? We can't make rules for some group having an advantage than other groups, you know. And what you say is quite true. Today, if you went to see a 100-meter final, you will see 8 black gentlemen,
yes,
there.
Absolutely.
2 of them will be from United States, 2 will be from Jamaica, 2 will be from Great Britain, 2 from Canada, and 2 from Portugal.
Yeah.
But they're all looking hardly Portuguese, hardly anything, okay? Now, if you trace their ancestry, where did these 8 guys come from? They all came from the west coast of Africa,
yeah,
around the places which are known as Sierra Leone, Gabon, and so on.
Yeah.
Now, why are from there? Because that's where the whole slave trade started. And if you look at the slave trade, how does the slave trade operate? They catch the victims from the villages, line them up, and the slave trader will come and he'll go and look, and he wants to buy 5. Who will he buy? Will he buy the thin-looking fellow who's hunched like that, or he'll pick the tough guy? He'll pick the toughest guys and put on his boat, right? So that's the first selection. Then in the boat is a hard journey. Only the fit survive. Okay, so by the time they reach the destination in the Caribbean, all the weak fellas have died. So that's the second step of selection. The third selection is they put them very hard work. More will die there. So that's the third step of selection. So all the progeny that you have been highly selected for the best genes.
Yes.
Okay, so what genes do they have? One particular gene they have which gives them fast twitch fibers.
Yes.
Now, you know, muscle is fast and slow twitch fibers. The fast twitch fibers are good for explosive events. Anything from 100 meters to long jump to boxing, to basketball, to all that. You know, fast twitch. In fact, I mean, it's very hard for them to sit still. Again, no offense, they're twitching all the time. They're rhythmic and twitching. They're very active. Because that's the thing they have. It's an advantage. So it's something that we have to... you know, it's the nature, somehow naturally it has evolved. We can grumble about it, why we are not switching, but you know, they have the fast twitch fibers. By contrast, you look at events 5,000 meters and onwards, you find people from East Africa, Somalia, Tunisia.
Yes.
Why? Because they are the different somato type, as well as they got slow twitch fibers. Now, slow twitch fibers give you what you call advantage in endurance events, because they are slow, they can last a long time. You know, so these are realities. We can't put a law against it, but you know what is happening? People are taking these genes, and that's what I mentioned, gene doping. You now have the ability to take those genes and transplant into people who don't have them, so that they convert them into with those properties, you know. So we are interfering as an anti-doping movement only with artificial and man-made interferences. What has been done by evolution or by nature, I mean, we accept. I mean, the world is not made of equal people, you know.
Yeah.
I mean, we have short people. I mean, look at basketball. If you're not 6 feet five or nearly 7 feet, what chance do you have? Unless we create a new class of basketball for those under 5 feet. I mean, you know, and why not? If we can have for weightlifting, boxing, and all different classes, why can't we have three classes for basketball? Under 5 feet, under 6 feet, and under 7 feet. You know, I mean, if you want to argue, huh? So, you know, it's difficult to stretch your point, you know. But we have to accept, we have to accept that the world is not, I mean, human beings are not made equal or fair, but that, you know, we try to make use of what we have. Now, for this, I got my own formula, you know, called HAB. You know what's a HAB? You know, this is my own formula,
okay.
Called HAB. What is HAB? It's height achieved, you know, in relation, you know, with H-A-R-P, height achieved versus real potential.
Real?
Height achieved versus real potential. So what I'm trying to say is, each person, we try to measure ourselves against other people, we get very frustrated. So each of us should measure what we can achieve with what we are given. So in other words, an index of a person's success or failure must be measured against his own potential, you know, to be fair to him. You know, so that he does not feel that he's a failure. For instance, why in sports, why must everybody only be a champion and only one competitor, right? People must enjoy sports also. So there's nothing wrong with a 5 feet fella trying to play basketball because he's enjoying the game. He may not make it to the national squad, but he enjoys his game. So why must we stop him? So let him reach primary school level and maybe he doesn't go further. But he enjoys playing basketball. So as sports people, we should allow and encourage everybody. So what is important is, I think among 5 feet tall fellows, he probably be the best. So he has achieved a height, very high in relation to his real potential. So he's a success. So, you know, we need to motivate people like that. No, so anyway, I digress. But, you know.
Continuing with the same, like, you see, we have separated the games on gender basis. With the same theory which you have. Is there any consideration, or would you support this idea that, you see, it should be on the legs of the person also?
Okay, coming to that subject, gender afterwards. Alright? But he's still rewarded. He's rewarded, and that way enables us to catch the entourage. So they are giving this kind of incentives now, officially. Officially encouraging whistleblowing as part of the rules. Next is non-analytical violations. In the past, drug athletes were punished only if they fail a drug test. But more and more now, we know that there are many other circumstances. If you look at the WADA code, rule 2.1, you'll find 8 situations in which it's an anti-doping rule. So what you need to get impressed in your mind is, there's a difference between an adverse analytical result. An adverse analytical result is a positive test in a drug test. Now, an adverse analytical result is not automatically an anti-doping rule violation, because maybe the guy took a drug for which there's a TUE, or maybe they made a severe mistake in the testing process. So it doesn't automatically become an anti-doping rule violation. All right? On the other hand, adverse analytical findings can become anti-doping, most of them can become anti-doping rule violations, not all. And the other way around, anti-doping rule violations are not all due to adverse analytical findings. There can be other things. And you see the 8 situations in the WADA code, things like supplying a drug, attempting to take a drug, even attempting to take, even before taking, attempting, carry the injection with you and with the bottle, and you turned up, and as you were about to inject, they caught you, and they found it's a steroid. That's enough. Or, you know, so there are all these provisions you can see in the WADA code. I won't go through with that here. But what I'm trying to say is today it's expanded. There are all these things that you have.
This clause is present in the
anti-doping rules. You
so
have picked it up.
This clause is
we have picked it up. So, yeah, good. The next one is criminalization. Now, more and more countries are making anti-doping rules criminal. Straight away, I can tell you Italy, France, Spain, Germany, I think, have already put this in their law. So if you're caught in this thing, it's a police case. And they can be put in jail and all that, you know. So it becomes, now countries are encouraged to work with, law enforcement agencies, to try and get relationship with them. Okay. So now, it's 30 years since, I told you about the Danish cyclist, 1960. It took them 7 years to form the IOC Medical Commission. So you see how bureaucracy works. From the time the guy died, took them 7 years to form the IOC Commission, but they tested the first time in 1968. But they decided in 1968 we'll test, but you know, we're not so sure, we won't punish anybody yet, but we're just testing. And in 72 they did the first test and punished 6 athletes or something like that. So after that, of course, the rest is history. So, but you know now, there's 30 years already, 30 years now we're doing this. Have we won the war? No, we are still far from winning. No. Many things to do, I already told you all the challenges. Okay. Many things to be done. But do we give up? Well, there are two views. One view, I already told you, where they say, look, why waste your time? Let them take, after all, it's a free world. The guy wants to take the win, why disturb him? You know, some people believe that, but I told you what will happen. Much pass will be by drug companies, not by countries. Okay. Secondly, the other group says, fight harder. So I think most of us are sitting here because we are believers that we must continue this fight. And why can't we give up? Because for the health reasons. All these drugs will kill our athletes. They will drop dead before they are 50. You know? Secondly, for ethics and for fair play, I told you. Now, remember the games of snakes and ladders. How many of you have played snakes and ladders? All of you, I think everybody should know. Do you know where this game was invented?
No.
Anybody knows?
No.
Actually, India.
Oh.
Yeah. And the beauty about this game, snakes and ladders, is that as long as you're not willing not to stand up and go away, you can reach the finish, you know. If you don't believe me, try next Sunday. Alright, sit down there and don't leave your seat. Keep on playing. The snakes will bring you down, the ladders will bring you up. But if you're patient, say, take your lunch, dinner and everything there. But you will end the top, believe me. Believe me. Because, you know, at the end, the averages in your favor will get you to the end. Some people will get there very fast, some will take. So the moral of the story is, treat anti-doping like snakes and ladders. Don't give up. Okay, finally you'll get to the top. Right, so that's the philosophy we have, right? Okay, now we switch on to gender. Now, before 1928, Olympic Games, only men were allowed. Good or bad?
Good.
Tradition. That was the tradition.
Okay, fair enough. So, but in 1928, they decided, look, we must introduce female events. But they also realized, you know, at that time, coming back to your little philosophy, I mean, at first they said, just come and compete. You know, I mean, doesn't matter, men or women, all compete, the best, fastest, highest. Then they realized, no, this is not fair, because physically we are not made the same. And I think, in spite of every movement by the, you know, feminist movements, equality and all that, in all areas, physically, I think even the ladies will not challenge. That there are certain things you can't do, us guys can do better. Am I right or not?
Nice.
Like running 100 meters, carrying weights. Because, you know, that's how our bodies are made. We respond, we make testosterone. Not only we make testosterone, our nerve, our muscle endings and our receptors respond to the testosterone. So it's not just making the drug, you know. We have to respond to it. For instance, if men and women took the same weight training regime tomorrow, with the same regime, same weights, the men will build the muscles much better than the woman. Why? Because our receptors are... will respond to the resistance, you know. Whereas the women don't have the same level of receptors to respond to the resistance in the same way of making the muscles. So if you see in the women's bodybuilding competition nowadays, when you see muscles that look very strange, I think you can guess what's going on. They're enjoying the benefits of male hormones. Otherwise, they cannot be building muscles like that, you know, because generally the women's receptors in the muscles will not respond to exercise in the same way. So acknowledging this, they decided to keep separate events for men and women. And basically, what's the difference? The difference is basically is the hormones. It's the androgen-driven difference, basically. That's what separates us physically. It's the level of androgens that we make and we respond to. Now, when we handle such issues, now, what is the issue now? The issue is that every now and then, you'll hear a complaint either from fellow competitors or from the public or from the journalists of some athlete in the women's event who is performing exceptionally well, winning all the things, but not looking as dainty or as feminine or as ladylike as people would like them to be. So they'll come and complain and say, look, she's got a moustache. Listen to her voice. It's so rough. You know, she looks like a boy. See how she's walking. Look at her legs. You know what I mean? You know, all these things we'll get from time to time. And so we have to handle this. Now, we as medical people got to handle this in a slightly different, in a major difference from the way we handle anti-doping. Anti-doping, we name and shame. Now, we have no hesitation to catch a fellow and name and shame him. But in this case of gender, we have to tread very carefully. Because many of these things are not of the persons doing it. People can't help what they look like. I mean, we are born in all different ways. Many things happen between the time we are conceived and the time we come out with all our blastocysts and our cells and everything. You know, a lot of things happen. Some of us don't have the normal evolutionary, gestation and everything. And so we come out with some kind of mixed things, not our fault. And straight away, what happens? Every one of us at birth is subjected to a definition. And we only know two definitions, you know, male or female. Sometimes it's done by obstetricians. You know, hospital is done by nurses and all that as well. But a lot of the times, these are done in villages, you know. By who? By policemen, hitmen, neighborhood, you come, you just open the door, you got baby today. What happens? They look for some very easily identifiable parts to call it a boy, right? Now, if the thing hasn't come down yet, they will think it's a girl. And they label it as a girl from that moment, and that child is brought up as a girl. Suddenly, at the age of 18 years old, she's winning some 100 meters, and you tell her she's a boy. You know, she's brought up as a girl for 18 years in the house. And of course, she had all this strength, so she runs and she wins. It's like a, and she wins. Suddenly, you tell her you cannot win because you're a boy. So can we handle it like a doping case? We can't. Because, you know, we have to handle very delicately. It must be told, look, at the way you are, we are sorry, but you're not eligible because you are enjoying the unfair benefits of a male profile. There are many underlying reasons to this. We have, after due testing and everything, we have now resolved that you have a hormonal profile of a male. You have either a genetic makeup or a chromosomal makeup or something that gives you this unfair advantage, and we cannot allow you to continue in female competition. That's the first point. But the second point is, there are things that can be done to restore your profile. It's your choice. What is your mind? You know that there is this phenomenon where people with a women's mind trapped in a male body. I mean, there are women in all instances psychologically. They're trapped in a male body, they want to be girls. And they want to execute the right to be girls. So we have processes for that. We have processes for that surgically, hormonally, and so on. So we don't deny anybody the right of choice. So an athlete who has been found like this, we have to offer them the choices. So what are the interventions we can do to make you eligible? But the athlete can refuse. It's her right to refuse. She said, no, I don't want all this, let me just retire. And so what do? We say they have gone for further studies. We never say they failed a drug gender test. We say that so-and-so has retired from sport to go do a PhD. And she'll disappear for 3 years and people will forget about it. But if she chooses and says, yes, as far as I'm concerned, in my mind, I'm a girl, I cannot be anything else but a girl, and I want to be a girl, I have my right to compete, yes. So we can do the following things. Example, we can take out the undescended testes. And in a way, it's good to take out anyway. You know what's the problem with undescended testes, isn't it? Medically, that's cancer. So it's even though they're not participating, you might even recommend that from the health point of view. So there are these things. And then you give hormonal replacement. And you take maybe 6 months, 8 months, 1 year, and then you monitor the profile until she has the hormonal profile of a male, of a female, then you say, now you are eligible to go back. So we have panels which can do this now. So the 2 points I want to say is, one, total confidentiality during the process, and secondly, nobody is to be discriminated. We have to evaluate carefully what is the issue and help them get back inside.
The same thing applies to the intersex state.
Yes, exactly. Exactly. That's why I'm saying nobody. See, the world is so clear-cut, you know. When you label people, they are so clear-cut, but the human race is not so clear-cut. I mean, you have a whole spectrum, you know, of gender determination. And gender and sex are two different things. Sex is what's determined by our chromosome. Now, we are supposed to have two X's or one X and Y. We call that, and we define sex by that. So if I have X and Y, my sex is a male. But my gender does not necessarily have to be a male. You know. Gender is what is phenotypic and what I myself may determine to be. I want to be a female gender, that's my right today. I mean, people exercise such rights. Okay? And so we have systems to adjust to that, you know? I mean, not everybody may agree with this. Not every culture, every religion accepts this, but the world by large, accept that there are this spectrum, you know? Okay?
There is one thing that we, as far as confidentiality is concerned, we usually, there is so big media, and the athlete herself or himself went to the media and...
No, what they do, we can't control. But we must not be the party that is responsible for the leaks. I mean, if the athlete runs out and tells the whole world, what can you do? But we must not be, not like a drug case. Drug case, we got specific principles of disclosure. I mean, after the hearing, we are within 20 days, we have to announce the hearing, you know, name the cheat and everything, you know, name the sanction and all that. We are obliged to do that. See? So, it's different. But this one, we must handle very delicately. Like I said, even finally, if the athlete says, okay, I'll quietly withdraw, we don't say, oh, so-and-so is stopping competing because she failed her gender test, you know. No, we say she's gone for higher studies. See, she, you know, find a way to get her to withdraw quietly if she doesn't want to go through the process. Even to go through the process of change takes her maybe 2 years. So even for 2 years, it's good to go for higher studies. You know? That's what we do. Yeah. Okay. So now, I said for sports, we all acknowledge that men and women have different qualities, so we have to separate that. But there are four sports in which the gender does not matter. That is equestrian. Apparently the horse doesn't know the difference. Horse is not fussy who sits on top, you know. So we don't worry. Archery is another one, apparently. And shooting and yachting, but you know, shooting also we have, you know, although it shouldn't be, actually shooting, actually there's no reason to separate. But we need to separate from tradition.
Archery
is separated. Yes, that's what I'm saying. But they've done studies. They actually found that in archery, shooting and so on, you don't really get a benefit by being a male. So they could amalgamate, but because of tradition and so on, we are keeping it separate. Yachting is the same thing, you know. So these are the only four sports. So when we are confronted with this, as medical personnel, we must ask ourselves certain questions before we proceed. First question is, whether the athlete is a male to female or female to male. Now, nobody cares if a woman wants to come and compete in a male's event, they are most welcome. They really don't care. Because, you know, I mean, what advantage? And we have got one or two examples. We've got some golfers and so on who have chosen to come and compete with the boys. You know, nobody worries. We don't say, no, girls can't come in here. Unless it's a club rule or something. Some clubs still have these rules, you know. Some courses girls can't play, you know. And so on. But otherwise, if a girl wants to come and compete with a male, generally nobody will worry about it. Because she's not bringing any advantage unless she's distracting all the other competitors. Okay. Now, so that is the first question. Second question is the sport affected by gender? I mean, if it's archery or something, you don't make a big fuss. You say, nah, let her go and shoot. You know, why are you fussing around? If a shooter, somebody complains, the shooter was not a girl, why is she shooting? You don't take such an aggressive, you know, approach. You know, really. Then, what are the physical characteristics of the individual? Now, we can do an assessment, you know. Do they have male characteristics? Typical male characteristics. All those things you all know. Then, is there likely to be a real or perceived competitive advantage? So, these are the first screening questions in your mind to know whether to proceed or not. So if you're not convinced that the athlete is enjoying some benefit, then try to avoid the subject, you know. Don't pursue this and embarrass everybody and all that. All right? So that's your first screen. You only move in if you really feel that injustice is being done. Why injustice? Because although we want to be fair to individuals, we have to be fair to all the other girls who are competing, isn't it? They also deserve deserve justice, you know. Not that this girl is doing anything criminal, but, you know, you have to think of the others too. And that's our responsibility, keeping sports fair and clean. Okay? How are we for time?
Just keep right.
Okay. Okay.
No. You can continue.
Okay. So now, again, just like we recognize in doping, we got the accidental, the victim, and the willing. So here also, you know, there are different types. One is gender fraud. Gender fraud is where a person actually, they are taking, you know, boys and putting them into girls' event to win. There are people doing this, where they can go around the countryside. Actually, if we didn't do anything about this, this can become the new frontier for talent spotting, you know. You just go around the countryside, look for such people and bring them into your teams. If suppose there's no rule or nothing, they'll win your weightlifting, they'll win your all these events, they'll win hands down. You go to the countryside, I'm sure you can find. Because some of them have labeled them wrongly from the beginning. And don't forget, there's also this other phenomenon that many cultures, they want boys selectively. So even if a girl is boy, sometimes they pretend and try to bring up the girl as a boy. You know? So you can work that way too, and other ways. So we have to deal with all of this. So there can be gender fraud. Second, gender misrepresentation. This is where we feel sorry for these people, you know. They were misrepresented, brought up as a girl. Why? Because maybe the parents wanted the girl to have six other boys, or whatever it is, or the hitman who came to certify didn't look properly, or the testis didn't descend and he thought it's a girl. You know, so many things. So misrepresentation, but from that day onwards, the child is doomed, brought up as a girl. The first opportunity she'll be given dresses to wear. So, you know, this happens. Then there's this genuine transgender, your point. Genuine. Genetically, in the whole process, they've got a mosaic pattern. But they're actually hermaphrodites. You know, they make both organs and they've got both qualities. So you have to deal with that too. Then there's intersex, is hermaphrodites. And then also, there are, you know, the various medical syndromes where there's insensitivity to testosterone and so on. So although he's a boy, he's producing testosterone, but he doesn't have the receptors for testosterone, you know. So he gets girl characteristics but enjoys the hormones. Now in that kind of case, you may not do anything, you know, because the person is not enjoying the benefits of the testosterone. And because the testosterone is not working, he actually has a lot of female characteristics. So you have to evaluate all of this. So not everybody you interfere in. So doesn't matter if the genetics was XY, but if the whole body didn't respond to the testosterone, the person is a female, as far as we are concerned. So you have to evaluate very carefully. Alright, and there are many congenital and pathological conditions which allow to bring you to this. So, you know,
Would you go in for X, Y, and XX on a chromosomal basis or it's on the gender?
No. It's no more. Sports, I'm coming. You know. No more. No more. We used to do that. That's why I said gender history or gender verification, we did that before. Today, totally banned. Nobody does that. Those days, every athlete, you know, in a major competition must line up, get a buccal smear or a hair root, and they go and look for the bar body, which is the extra X chromosome, and they give you a certificate. You know, all the girls used to carry a certificate to certify that she's a girl for competition. All that was stopped. Okay, because they found many anomalies and misdiagnoses that way. Because they're not interested in X, Y, now. What they want to know is, like I said, the question is that person, we don't care whether X, Y, what not, is that person enjoying the benefits of a male hormone profile? That's the question to answer. How she got the profile, then you got to find out. Okay? So these are some of the things very quickly. Okay. So basically, the IOC has stopped doing gender verification. You know, no more this routine. Now all of us have stopped doing as a routine. So what we do in competitions, we only respond to challenge. Meaning that if somebody comes up to us and say, hey, look, this is going on, then we have a way to respond. And how do we respond? We have a panel who will study the case. The panel will consist of experts in endocrinology, experts in gynecology, experts in psychological profiling, and all this. And panel will give a multidisciplinary approach to making a final decision as to whether this person is enjoying the benefits of a male structure. If she's enjoying, then you have to tell her, look, you're not eligible for the following reasons, and this is what we would recommend you can do if you want to participate. Then the choice is hers. Okay? So I don't have time to go deeper, but that's the philosophy. So I missed a couple of slides. You just come to your next point of gene doping. Now, earlier you talked about the black guys and the advantage in sprinting and all that. Now people beginning to manipulate with genes, and they actually have the technology now. They have the technology. So it's a question of us being able to find out. So now, the methodology to gene dope is available, and we are watching carefully whether it's going on or not. And this is the definition of gene doping. Transfer of cells or genetic elements, or the use of cells, genetic elements, or pharmacological agents to modulate an expression of endogenous genes having the capacity to enhance athletic performance. Fast twitch fibers, slow twitch fibers, all these things. You can manipulate. Okay? Now, look at this experiment with mice. Now, can you see the mice on the last column? Can you look at their muscles? All because just one gene, they just changed one gene. And the mouse was able to grow like this. So can you imagine what potential we can do with this gene doping? Okay. Now age cheating, very quickly. Age cheating is another issue because now we have youth and juniors competition. And now what is happening is governments are rewarding these young people now too much. Frankly, that's my opinion. I mean, you shouldn't give young people these bad habits of waiting for financial rewards for winning a youth games. But they're giving big rewards now. So, again, you know, the entourage is encouraging them to compete and cheat with the age, and all sorts of things are coming in now. Why? Because there are rewards. All right? So now we as doctors are asked now, many times in competitions, is this age correct or not? Look at the guy. Is he 17? He looks like 25 to me. Sometimes you're quite right. So what do we do medically? Okay. And it works both ends. There are some events we don't want them when they're too young, you know, like gymnastics. Like Olympic Games, if you're not 14, you cannot compete in gymnastics. Why? Because we don't want them, manipulating so much until they break off the epiphysis and all that, you know, because they're very soft. So gymnasts to be in Olympic Games must be 14, and athletes have been caught cheating. 12, 13-year-olds have been pretending to be 14 to be in the Olympics because they are so good and they win gold medals.
Even
there was
the
a case.
Even for the floor exercises.
Whatever, you know. They have put an age. That's a gymnastics federation rule. I mean, not 100% medically supported, but I mean it's a rule, and the rule was to protect. Okay, so now, so what can we do? We can do radiometric measurements of bone, okay? We can study dental structures. We can study the skull. We can study the long bone ossification or the fusion of epiphysis of long bones. These are all the materials forensically we use for aging, for determining age. But the catch is, there's no fixed point, you know. There's a range. It's not like finding a chemical, yes or no. It's not like finding a chromosome X or Y. This is one of those things that's human biological variation. Not every one of us on our birthday gets something. You know? So we are chronologically and biologically there can be a disjunction. Okay? We accept that. So basically the current methods that we offer as doctors lack precision. Alright? And we have to compare the developmental age versus the chronological age. Not always the same. Depending a lot, you know, on nutrition and all that. I mean, if you have a malnourished child, will take a longer time. They're stunted, you know. So it's quite difficult. And age, although is a linear, age is a linear factor, but growth comes in spurts, you know. And we have different spurts at different times, affected by so many things. So what we do now is, the best way would be to do standard radiographs of the left wrist, but nowadays X-rays are not allowed anymore, you know, for sport. Most organizations don't allow for obvious reasons. And MRI can be done, but it's very expensive. So now they're working on the potential of trying to introduce ultrasound as a way to determine this thing, you know, because just for a sports purpose to go and do an X-ray doesn't seem ethically right. It's hard to defend. Can you imagine taking all the young fellas and subjecting them to X-ray of the wrist? You know, it's a moral issue.
Even it is not precise.
Pardon?
Even if we do all, even it is not
exactly. Precise. So our justification is not strong enough to subject them to that. So, and then there's so much genetic, racial, gender, health, nutrition variations. So many variables. So perhaps now what we are able to do at this moment with the current knowledge, we can age to 8 to 12 months, we can with confidence. So if somebody is cheating more than 1 year, we can catch them. You know, if they are 2 years older than the group, I think we can catch them. We've got enough knowledge to do that. But if they're cheating by 6 months or 4 months or something, nothing.
How are we going to catch them, sir? How are we going to catch
them? Well, we do this test. What I'm trying to say is this test, you must give a margin of error of 1 year at least. Say if the guy fails the test according to our norms, you have to give him 1 year bonus, you know, before you disqualify him. So if a fellow is 4 years older, you know, you catch him. Because it's within that period, you definitely have all the changes and you'll be able to catch him.
There is no value for the documentation he provides for the age.
He brings his passport and all that, but you know, what is a passport? The passport is only as good as the guy who put his signature on it. Alright. So basically, what they are looking for now, yes, coming back to this, they don't want to recognize the current passport you carry. But they want to try to look at you must bring your earliest life authenticated age document. All of us will have a birth certificate somewhere. The original, you know. Now you bring that. Now that one, we will accept.
There can also be a
certain Pakistan that is more like this.
I know, but many countries have this.
Yeah,
like in all honesty, I tell you, in the Malaysian system, there's no child can be born whom we don't know and who we have not issued a birth certificate. You know, so that we recognize.
But there is a rule in Bhutan, I think, about the age.
Uh-huh.
By the time the mother got pregnant, they start to count the age. I've heard this in Bhutan. So by the time when he got birth, I mean, so he
already
is already
one year old.
He's already 1 year old. So what are you going to do in that case?
No. We don't recognize that. We recognize the date of coming out in the world, making your first cry.
But they made already the birth certificate.
I know. So they have to explain that. You're right. Even the Chinese, original Chinese, recognize birthdays from the time of conception. So, yes,
Japan,
we have to adjust for all that.
Also
yeah. Okay? Right. So now, some other things that people are talking about may come. They say, look, age is very hard to find. So why don't we go for some maturity indicator, such like as a height or weight? Because although that's not perfect, but at least you can say, okay, sorry for you. I mean, you might be 18, but if you are 6 feet tall, sorry. You know, we don't. And in a way, it's fair, isn't it? Because you are much taller than all your peers. You got an advantage. You got a growth spurt early. So, although you are less than 18, we say, look, based on height, sorry, you know. I think that, in a way, that may be the answer. Because what we are looking at is the indicator, outcome of what you are. Accepting that there's biological variation. Why do we put an age? Because we think the young fellow cannot compete with the old fellow. He's not mature yet. But some people mature early. So if we can get the maturity index, then we can use that. It's not come yet, but this is the next frontier to explore it. Okay, altitude chambers, very quickly. These are boxes where you can live inside, where they have adjusted the atmosphere to mimic the high altitude. So you stay there the whole day, but when you train, you go and train outside. Why? Because you want to do the road. You can work hard, but you cannot work inside there. So you just go out maybe 1-2 hours or anything you need to go out. The rest of the time you spend in the altitude chamber. So they had a big debate for 2 years, you know, whether this is legal or not. Finally, they said it's legal, so you can buy now. You can rush out and buy and put in your sports, in your sports board. You can buy one and keep in your field if you want. You can buy even from the internet. It's about $20,000 US, you know. So it's allowed. Okay. Now this issue of injection of platelet-rich plasma, a lot of doctors believe it has got growth factors and so on that really enhance. So initially big debate again. Now at the moment, they accept that it's allowed. So you can do that.
We had dengue last year. That was really too much. So we injected a lot of plasma.
Okay, so
in patients.
All right. So anyway,
anyway,
accept that. Then IV infusions, as I said, is a big thing now. It's also the no needle policy has come. So you don't want to see any needles anywhere. If he needs an IV infusion because he's dehydrated, you don't do it. You take him to the station and do it there. You don't get to try to be a hero and try to do these things yourself. Anything more than 50 cc's is considered an IV infusion. Don't have to see a bottle hanging there, you know? Okay, to define. Okay, that's it. Right, thank you. Okay, short tea break over here. Sorry. Thank you very much. Tea break. And a quick
long
tea break. And then 11:30 we'll be back.